One of the things that I didn't realize when I was young was how quickly people die. And when I lived in Cambridge, there were still certain legendary figures there, such as Wittgenstein and the famous mathematician G.H. Hardy. And both of those I could have met if only I'd exerted myself. I knew the nice lady, the nice doctor's wife, Joan Mevan, who in whose arms Wittgenstein died. And one of my friends at King's, one of the Dons, used to go and watch cricket with Hardy at the university cricket ground. And I had only to say to Christopher, I'd rather like to meet Hardy. I could have met him, but alas, I didn't. And Hardy, of course, was a very distinguished mathematician, but he's best known to the public, of course, by his book, A Mathematician's Apology. And I think I'm right in saying that he wrote that after the First World War, when people were saying that, you know, what had he done for the war effort? And that pure mathematics is quite useless, you see. And it was his attempt to explain to the British public that what the attraction of pure mathematics is. There's pure mathematics, as you understand, as well as applied mathematics. So some mathematics is developed in order to be used in physics or engineering or statistics or whatever it is. Other mathematics just exists. But one of the great justifications, curious enough, for pure mathematics is that every now and again something comes along which you think is totally inapplicable and purely airy-fairy mathematical theory, and then it turns out to be exactly the mathematics they need for some particular thing. There, I dare say most people have heard of the famous mysterious number, the square root of minus one. And the mathematics based on the square root of minus one, developed, well, mainly at the beginning of the 19th century, was long held to be a piece of pure mathematicians' fun and games, no useful purposes, whatever. But when electricity came along, particularly alternating current and vibrations and all that stuff, it turned out that these complex numbers, as they're called, based on the square root of minus one, were exactly the mathematical tool that you needed. That's the nice thing that happened. And so Hardy Setter, in The Mathematician's Apology, he sets out to try and indicate what he thought the value of pure mathematics was. And for him, it's aesthetic beauty. And of course, the trouble is that to explain to somebody who isn't a very good mathematician why a particular proof is beautiful is difficult. And the one he chooses is the famous demonstration that the square root of two it cannot be expressed as a fraction. If you write it down as a decimal, it will have to go on forever, and what is more, never repeat itself. And was it Pythagoras? The proof he gives goes back a very, very long way, and it's very slick. It only takes about three lines. But when you look at it, you know, if you have any feeling for what's going on, you realise, jolly, that's clever, and it really goes straight to it. It doesn't fuss. It has an elegance, we could say. And that's what his book is all about. The Mathematician's Apology. And as I say, I was sorry that I never met him. Because he wrote, on another occasion, during the First World War in Trinity, where he was, there was an argument about Bertrand Russell. Bertie Russell was a pacifist, and indeed wrote a book. Was it about America? Anyway, he said things that were not well viewed by the government, and he was actually sent to jail during the First World War. For his pacifist views. And at Trinity College, where he was a fellow of the college, needless to say, a lot of the fellows were traditional old-fashioned Englishmen and viewed what Russell was up to with great horror. But Hardy got together with a group of young Turks and said, you know, spirit of free inquiry, respect people's points of view, provided they explain their ways of thinking and so forth. And so there's a book in which he describes the campaign he got up to have Russell reinstated as a fellow and lecturer in the Trinity College. And it's full of remarkable little remarks that give one enormous joy. For instance, he quotes from a pamphlet he circulated in connection with, which it contains the phrase, "I'm sure I can appeal to the fellows to treat this matter on the merits of the case." And then he remarks, the older Hardy remarks, "I'm surprised I was so naive." I think that's a very jolly thing. Alas, Russell at that point got divorced for, was it the first time? And perhaps he was even living in sin with Dora by then. And this was another sort of source of contention. Because although nowadays, I dare say, nobody asks what the domestic circumstances of the fellows and lecturers are, back in the old days they did. And Russell, very sensibly, rather sweetly, withdrew from the contest. He said, you know, it'll all get muddled up with, you know, his marital arrangements, and he doesn't want, you know, to put his supporters to any problems. So in fact, but anyway, Hardy's book about this whole performance is very entertaining.